Good morning. I welcome you all to worship, whether you're here in person or those of you watching remotely. As you see, I'm not Bill Banks. Bill asked me to fill in for him this Sunday as he had a conflict that came up. Do we have any announcements?
Good morning. I was over to the Wyoming Family Restaurant, and we are paid up for our meal on Tuesday evening. We are going to be serving 35 people at Save Burke's. And I don't know if you were, I think we did say before, but there are men now. That's why I think it became Save Burke's, because it's not just women in crisis, it's men in crisis too. So I'm hoping that we can do it again. So if you so feel you can help us, we'd like you to donate and earmark that it's for Save Burke's. And again, we can do a meal. We'll be feeding 35 on Tuesday from our church. And I think I had told you before, but really in proportion, we have more people in Berks County that are in that situation than in the city of Philadelphia. So there is a definite need. And I appreciate your help.
Any other announcements? Seeing none, let us prepare our hearts for worship with the organ prelude. We meet one another here today, bringing the whole of who we are as members united in one body. We bring each of our individual gifts given to us by God to serve. Gather us in spirit of wisdom so that we may be the one body you have created. Many, many, and still one. Please join me in the prayer of the day. Holy One, we thank you for the gift of the Bible, for its psalms and poems, myths and stories, histories, teachings, and prophecies. May the Holy Spirit call out those ancient writings, continue to call us out today, that our lives may reflect the first sermon of Jesus, our crucified and risen Christ, who brings good news to the poor and lets the oppressed go free. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
God of strong, God to whom all things. right. God who love turns wrong to right.
In the light of Christ, we see the darkness of our world and of our hearts. Trusting in God's saving love, let us confess our sin. Creator God, we know that you have made us to work with one another as one body. But too often, we find it easier to stay with what feels familiar or comfortable. We set priorities that serve our own interests, dividing the body as we say to other members, I have no need for of you. When we see pain and injustice, we try not to share in suffering. Yet we are eager to share in celebrations we have neglected to earn. We cling to our individualism and abandon the call to be the generous caretakers of your whole creation. You have set us up for all. Embolden us to honor both the gifts in ourselves as well as the gifts in others. Strengthen us to live into the discomfort so that we may become the body you have created us to be. We fall short, God's forgiveness never ceases. Live into the good news that in Jesus Christ you are forgiven and free to answer God's call to live as one body. As a sign of our oneness in Christ, let us share the gift God has given. The peace of Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Amen. God, your word is a light to our feet and a guide to our path. And we pray now that as Holy Scripture is read by the power of your Holy Spirit, Lord, we would see your light and we would walk in your way to the glory of your name. Oh, Lord, by the power of your Spirit, make us receptive to your word today. Through Christ, amen.
Our epistle reading for this morning is 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verses 12 through 31a, found in your pew Bible on page 174 of the New Testament. And if I'm remembering correctly, if paid attention, we started chapter 12 last week. All right. Glad I'm actually paying attention. Okay. Beginning on verse 12. For just as the body is one, and has many members, and all the members are of the body, though many, are one body, so it is with Christ. For in the one Spirit we were all baptized into one body, Jew or Greeks, slaves or free, and we were all made to drink of one Spirit. Indeed, the body does not consist of one member, but of many. If the foot would say, because I am not a hand, I do not belong to the body, that would not make it any less a part of the body. And if the ear would say, because I am not an eye, I do not belong to the body, that would not make it any less a part of the body. If the whole body were an eye, where would the hearing be? If the whole body were hearing, where would the sense of smell be? But as it is, God arranged the members of the arranged the members in the body, each one of them, as he chose. If all were a single member, where would the body be? As it is, there are many members, yet one body. The eye cannot say to the hand, I have no need of you, nor again the head to the feet, I have no need for you. On the contrary, the members of the body that seem to be weaker are indispensable. And those members of the body that we think less honorable, we clothe with greater honor, and our less respectable members are treated with greater respect. Whereas our more respectable members do not need this. But God has so arranged the body, giving the greater honor to the inferior member, that there may be no dissension within the body, but the members may have the same care for one another. If one member suffers, all suffer together with it. If one member is honored, all rejoice together with it. Now you are the body of Christ and individually members of it. And God has appointed in the church first apostles, second prophets, third teachers, then deeds of power, and gifts of healing, forms of assistance, forms of leadership, various kinds of tongues. Are all apostles, are all prophets, are all teachers? Do all work miracles? Do all possess gifts of healing? Do all speak in tongues? Do all interpret? But strive for the greater gifts, and I will show you a still more excellent way. Our Psalter today is Psalm 19. Found in your pew Bible on page 498 of the Old Testament. Let's read this responsively. I'll begin and with the odd verse number one, and you will follow. The heavens are telling the glory of God, and the firmament proclaims his handiwork. There is no speech, nor there are there words. Their voice is not heard. Which comes out like a bridegroom from his wedding canopy, and like a strong man runs his course with joy. The law of the Lord is perfect, reviving the soul. The decrees of the Lord are sure, making wise the simple. The fear of the Lord is pure, enduring forever. The ordinances of the Lord are true and righteous altogether. Moreover, by them is your servant warned. In keeping them, there is great reward. Keep back your servant also from the insolent. Do not let them have dominion over me. Then I shall be blameless and innocent of great transgression. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable to you, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer.
Is it getting better? Do you feel the same? Will it make it easy on you now? You got someone else to blame. Say one love, one life, one need in the disappoint you, leave a bad taste in your mouth, act like you've never had love, you want me to go without, well it's too late, tonight, to drag the past out. In the light, we're one, but we're not the same. Carry each other, carry each other. Have you come here for forgiveness? Have you come to raise the dead? Come here to play Jesus to the lepers in your head. Did I ask too much? More than a lot. Gave me nothing, now it's all I got. We're one, but we're not the same. We hurt each other, we do it again. You hear us coming, Lord. Hear us call, hear us knocking, knocking at your door. Hear us coming, Lord, you hear us call, you hear us scratching, make us crawl. You say, love is a temple, love the higher law. Love is a temple, love the higher law. Ask me to enter, made me crawl, can't be holding. holding on to what you've got, but all you got is hurt. One love, one blood, one life. You got to do what you should.
Thank you, David. Our gospel lesson this morning comes from Luke chapter 4, verses 14 through 21. Jesus has been tempted in the wilderness and has returned, and we read, "Then Jesus, filled with the power of the Spirit, returned to Galilee, and a report about him spread through all the surrounding country. He began to teach in their synagogues and was praised by everyone. When he came to Nazareth, where he had been brought up, he went to the synagogue on the Sabbath day, as was his custom. He stood up to read, and the scroll of the prophet Isaiah was given to him. He unrolled the scroll and found the place where it was written, 'The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim release to the captives, and recovery of sight to the blind, to let the oppressed go free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor.' He rolled up the scroll, gave it back to the attendant, and sat down. The eyes of all in the synagogue were fixed on him. Then he began to say to them, 'Today, this scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing.' The grass withers, the flower falls, but the word of our Lord endures forever. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. O Lord, for the gift of your word read, we give you thanks. And now as your word is proclaimed, we pray that insofar as what is said is true, you would write it on our hearts and give us the grace to believe. And insofar as what is said is false, may it fall to the ground, soon be forgotten, and do no harm. Amen. Excuse me. A thoughtful Christian asked me recently, how can religion bring our country back together? What is the church's role? Now, I can imagine someone surveying the toxic stew of politics and religion in recent years and saying, how can religion be a part of the solution when it's so clearly part of the problem? They have a point. So we begin with humility. We begin with confession. Like the church in Corinth, we are a divided and divisive people who fail to be the contemporary witness to our oneness in Christ, given in our baptism and continually empowered by the Holy Spirit, that we are called to be. Simply put, we are better than this. We are better than we have been. Paul reminds us, for just as the body is one and has many members, and all the members of the body, though many, are one body, so it is with Christ. For in the one Spirit we were all baptized into one body, Jews or Greeks, slaves or free. And we were all made to drink of the one Spirit. The body is one and has many members. That is to say, many distinctive individual parts, heads, shoulders, knees, and toes. They're all different, and they all have their purpose for the good of the whole. But we can be so focused on our particular segment that the whole has become fragmented. The individual, my group, my interests, me, means more than the whole. I mean more than us. Objectively, the body is not one. The church is not one. But here is a lifeline of grace. The body is one. The church is one because it is the body of Christ. The church is one because it is the body of Christ. We are one because through our baptism, whether we were sprinkled or dipped or dunked, infant or adult believer, all the many ways we can baptize, however it was that we were baptized, through our baptism, the Holy Spirit brings us together and makes us one. We are one. That is a gift. That is grace, not an achievement. And we bear witness to our God-given oneness every year when we pay our per capita, $43.13 this year, to support the Presbyterian witness in the world. And we Presbyterians are a diverse group of people with an opinion or two. And in Christ, we, as many as we are, as different as we are, as much as we disagree, we are one. And that witness of those who disagree yet remain in community, those who are not the same yet remain one, that witness is vital in our world today. A recent New York Times opinion piece asked, "Are we really facing a second civil war?" In the article, Michelle Goldberg, who teaches political science at the University of California, San Diego, wrote, "Two books out this month warn that this country is closer to civil war than most Americans understand. In How Civil Wars Start and How to Stop Them, Walter writes, I've seen how civil wars start, and I know the signs that people miss. And I can see, I can see those signs emerging here at a surprisingly fast rate. The Canadian novelist and critic Stephen March is more stark in his book, The Next Civil War, Dispatches from the American Future. The United States is coming to an end, March writes. The question is how. In Toronto's Globe and Mail, Thomas Homer Dixon, a scholar who studies violent conflict, recently urged the Canadian government to prepare for an American implosion. By 2025, American democracy could collapse, causing extreme domestic political instability, including widespread civil violence, he wrote. By 2030, if not sooner, the country could be governed by a right-wing dictatorship. As John Harris writes in Politico, serious people now invoke civil war, not as a metaphor, but as a literal precedent. Of course, not all serious people. Harvard political scientist Josh Kurtzer wrote on Twitter that he knows many Civil War scholars, and very few of them, think the United States is on the precipice of a civil war. Yet even some who push back on civil war talk tend to acknowledge what a perilous place America is in. In The Atlantic, Fintan O'Toole warns that prophecies of civil war can be self-fulfilling. During the long conflict in Ireland, he said, each side was driven by fear that the other was mobilizing. It's one thing, he writes, to acknowledge the real possibility that the U.S. could break apart and could do so violently. It is quite another to frame that possibility as an inevitability. I agree with O'Toole that it's absurd to treat civil war as a foregone conclusion, but that it now seems distinctly possible is still pretty bad. The fact that speculation about civil war has moved from the crankish fringes into the mainstream is itself a sign of civic crisis, an indication of how broken our country is. So my friend sees this and he asks again, how can religion bring our country back together? What is the church's role? Mahatma Gandhi taught us, be the change you seek. Martin Luther King Jr. studied Gandhi and Jesus and said, darkness cannot drive out darkness, only light can do that. Hate cannot drive out hate, only love can do that. Love is the only force capable of transforming an enemy into a friend. Let no man pull you so low as to hate him. And Paul put it this way, as it is, there are many members, yet one body. The eye cannot say to the hand, I have no need of you, nor again the head to the feet, I have no need of you. On the contrary, the members of the body that seem to be weaker are indispensable. And those members of the body we think less honorable, we clothe with greater honor. And our less respectable members are treated with greater respect. whereas our more respectable members do not need this. But God has so arranged the body, giving the greater honor to the inferior member. There may be no dissension within the body, but the members may have the same care for one another. Here is the countercultural message that will save religion from being its worst, the message that will save our nation from tearing itself apart in the name of freedom and rights, the message that will save the church from being just one more loud, angry voice in a sea of loud, angry voices we do not want for talking heads. Here's the message. I need you. I need you. The path forward is not the path of power trod by the high and mighty. The path forward is the path of vulnerability, tread by the meek and lowly. The path that Jesus trod as he gave his inaugural address, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He sent me to proclaim release to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to let the oppressed go free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." Jesus was not afraid to be vulnerable. He asked the woman at the well for a drink of water because he was thirsty. He wept over Lazarus because he was sad. He sought the company of Peter, James, and John in the, in the Garden of Gethsemane because he was afraid and he felt so alone. So don't expect the high and mighty to start this. Don't expect people in power to point the way. They didn't with Gandhi and the liberation of India from the British Empire. They didn't with Dr. King and the civil rights movement. They didn't with Archbishop Desmond Tutu and the end of apartheid in South Africa. And while President Reagan and Pope John Paul II get a lot of credit for the fall of the Soviet Union, it was the people who made the revolution happen. The grassroots toppled empires, set the oppressed free, and gave us all a glimpse of what the year of our Lord's favor looks like. Therefore, hold on to the infinite hope that King taught us to hold on to, and dare to be vulnerable. Dare to say to those who disagree with you and with whom you disagree, "We disagree, and I need you. We are one nation under God. America isn't America without you. I can't be a Christian without you." Stop arguing. Start embracing. End the civil war before it begins in your home, in your neighborhood, in your family, and yes, in your church. Get those grassroots growing. Dare to be vulnerable. Dare to say, "I need you." Amen. Our confession of faith comes from the Belhar Confession, which was also instrumental in toppling apartheid. Let us confess our faith. We believe in the triune God who gathers, protects, and cares for the church, one universal body called from the entire human family. We believe that unity is both a gift and an obligation for the church of Jesus Christ, and that this unity must be manifest and active in a variety of ways. These include that we love one another, that we pursue and practice community, that we are obligated to give ourselves willingly and joyfully to be of benefit and blessing to one another, that we need one another as we share in one faith, one calling, one soul, and one mind. Therefore, we reject any doctrine which causes sinful separation of people, breaks the active unity of the church, or professes unity while alienating one another. We believe that God calls the church to do what is good and to seek the right, to stand by people in suffering and need, to strive against injustice, and to bring about true peace among people. As we come to our time of offering again, we are participating in Per Capita Sunday with the whole Presbyterian Church as a way of just providing that baseline, that foundation that allows so many missions and ministries to move forward. This pays for the aspects of ministry that aren't particularly exciting, like paper and photocopiers and Wi-Fi connections. But because we pay for this. When the hour of need comes, every dollar goes to that need. So therefore, with joy, I thank those of you who have paid your per capita. If you haven't, I invite you to just put it on the memo part of your note. And as always, we thank you for your generosity that continues to amaze and astound and be the source of deep gratitude. Thank you. So now we offer you a minute of peace. We have one additional prayer request. Luann Rudnick, who is Gloria Springer's daughter, asks us to hold her in prayer this week. She will be having cataract surgery, as we want to continue to pray, lift her up in prayer, as well as continuing to pray for the folks we have mentioned. I don't have any updates on Guy or Paul. They are both, in Paul's case, facing surgery, and in Guy's case, recovering from surgery. We just don't know where. He is rehabbing. My guess is he probably went back to the Genesis nursing home on Philadelphia Avenue, but I don't know that. Pleased to report Andre Hauser is recovering and doing much better, and he thanks us for our prayers. And Steve Katzenmoyer's journey to recovery continues as well. And had a good conversation this week with Rabbi Brian Michelson and with what happened there. It was a great trauma with the event at Congregation Beth Israel. And unfortunately, our stated clerk of the denomination issued an unfortunate statement in which he compared the Israel-Palestine policy to enslavement. And I have written to the stated clerk to express my dissent with that, and also expressed to Brian, my deep dismay at that. So. And we are in relationship and meet together monthly, and he's a dear. Let us pray. Holy God, it is a wonder that you invite us into your oneness. You are Father, Son, Holy Spirit. You are one, united in love. And you invite us into that unity. And you invite us to model that unity in how we are with one another, yet, oh God, and so often that is the very last thing people see when they look at us. Forgive us, heal us, and make us whole. Make us one. Oh Lord, we long to be right. Grant us the humility to know that we can learn from one another, and that when we hear the voices of others, particularly those voices long silenced, oh Lord, our eyes can be open and we can be those blind who see. And oh Lord, we pray that you would grant us the grace and the courage to be humble enough to listen and to learn. Lord, we lift up our brothers and sisters in need. We pray for Sue and for Brad and for Bart and for Sarah as they continue to grieve for Ray. Lord, we thank you for the legacy of his witness among us to what unity and oneness looks like. And we ask, Lord, that that witness and their deep faith would be a source of comfort to them. We pray, O Lord, for Barbara as she is on hospice care down in North Carolina. We pray, O Lord, for your mercy and your grace to attend to her. We pray for Pete, Amanda, and Mike as they continue to grieve for Jerry. And Lord, we pray that your grace would be a source of sustaining strength in this hour. We pray for Grace and Lou and their family as they grieve the passing of her brother Harold. We ask your healing mercy for Guy Haig as he recovers from surgery and does his rehab, and for Paul as he faces surgery and needs significant healing. We give you thanks that Andre Hauser is doing better, and we ask your continued blessing upon him and for Steve as he embarks on the long road of recovery as well. And Lord, we give you thanks for the gift of brothers and sisters in the faith, our elder brothers, the Jewish community, and the good relationship we enjoy. Lord, we pray for the peace of Israel. And Lord, that somehow this division of Israeli and Palestinian could be resolved in a way that is just and right and true. You know, Lord, help us to do that in a spirit of humility and grace. Help us, O Lord, to listen to one another and not harm one another. And Lord, we pray as we celebrate the gift of being one church. Lord, we pray for our leaders as they seek to discern what it means to be the church in this new world in which we find ourselves. Lord, help us to be instruments of your peace. Help us to be instruments of your healing. Help us, O Lord, to be signs of grace in this world where there is so much trouble. We ask all of this in the name of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
We are one in the Spirit, we are one in the Lord. We are one in the Spirit, we are one in the Lord. And we pray that all unity one day be restored. And they'll know we are Christians by our love. Yes, they'll know we are Christians by our love. We will walk with each other, we will walk hand in hand. We will walk with each other, we will walk hand in hand. And together we'll spread the news that God is in our land. And they'll know we are Christians by our love, yes they'll know we are Christians by our love. We will work with each other, we will work side by side. We will work with each other, we will work side by side. And we'll guard human dignity and save human pride. And they'll know we are Christians by our love, yes they'll know we are Christians by our love. All praise to the Father for whom all things come. All praise to Christ Jesus, God's only Son. Praise to the Spirit who makes us one. They'll know we are Christians by our love, yes, they'll know we are Christians by our love.
Friends, we are not dismissed. We are sent to serve. We are sent to serve the needy with an open hand. We are sent to serve the stranger with an open mind. We are sent to serve our neighbor with an open heart. We are sent to serve our Lord, whom we will meet when we serve. And as we go forth to serve, know that we do not go alone. Jesus goes with us, above us to watch over us, beneath us to sustain us, beside us to befriend us, behind us to defend us, before us to show us the way, and always within us, making all things, including us, new. Go in peace. Go with God. Amen.
Amen.